all clap our hands and give the Lord just a big hand clap of thanksgiving. Amen, amen, amen. As a matter of fact, would you do me a favor? Would you shake hands with three or four people? Tell them happy anniversary, happy church anniversary here in Jesus Miracle Crusade, London Outreach. God bless you in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Amen. We certainly today, we give all the glory, honor, and praise to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The author and the finisher of our faith. Praise the Lord. Amen. We certainly want to greet and give double honor and respect to our beloved pastor, the true prophet of God, the end time prophet of our loving God. Amen. The honorable evangelist, Willie Estrada Almeida. Hallelujah. We'll always treasure the blessed memories of our beloved assistant pastor, Lena C. Almeida, beloved mama, who we love and we cherish. Amen. And we know that's in heaven now. Hallelujah. And rejoicing with the angels of the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah to my beloved wife, Deb. Amen. Love you so much. My daughter, Kelsey, and of course, our baby Reagan, the one who's in the back making all the noise. Amen. You know that Reagan is here in the house because he's the one making all the noise. Amen. But we're glad to have each and every one of you here with us today. All the preachers here, amen, those that are serving in ministry here at the Outreach, we just want to thank you, amen, for all that you do. Hallelujah. To be a part of this family of God, hallelujah, the royal body of Christ, amen. There is no greater joy in the world but to serve our dearest Jesus with all of our hearts. Can you say praise the Lord? Amen. All of you that are here that I have not met before, I truly count it an honor to be here with you today. Amen. The beloved Kubar family, thank you so much for all of you that have been cooking for us and preparing food. And amen, it's been delicious. Praise the Lord. I told my beloved wife, I said, my dearest wife, I said, when we go to England, amen, it'll be a good opportunity when we go to Europe so I can lose some weight. Amen. I'll be able to lose some weight so when I come back to the States, I'll look thinner. Hallelujah. But ever since I've been here, hallelujah, we've just been eating more than we do in the States. Hallelujah. I'm so riddled with guilt. But I'm excited that it's not going to stop me from fellowshipping. Hallelujah. And just so such a privilege and an honor. So let us lift our hands to Asakamai. Let's lift our hands to our dearest Jesus. Father, we love you so much. We thank you for this opportunity to come into your presence. We thank you for the prayers of our beloved pastor, Lord. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for this dwelling of the body of Christ. We give you the glory and the praise today, Lord, for every testimony, every solemn song, every worship and praise song, Lord God. We thank you for it. Lord, we thank you for these beloved testimonies, the beloved choir that has ministered to our hearts today. Lord, for the words for our beloved sweetheart, Death, Lord. God, and it's given us words of encouragement, Lord God, and life, Lord, today. We love you so much, dearest Jesus. Now, Father, we ask you, bless this message, bless this sermon, Lord God. May it reach each and every ear, every heart, every mind, Lord, that we may never be the same. In the name of Jesus, we cast out spirits that come against us, spirits of faithfulness, spirits of talent. In the name of Jesus, spirits that come to hinder and to bind, we bind and rebuke you. In Jesus' name we pray. Let the church say amen. God bless you in Jesus' name. Kindly open your Bibles to the book of 1 Kings. It's the rainy season and then the dry season. And we know that if you've ever spent time, and I'm sure everyone here has, when you spend the dry season and the rainy season, you go through months of where it seems it rains every day. When we were in the Philippines last year, we stayed for 1 year. We were there during the rainy season. And even if the sun was out, at some time during the day, the rain would come. It was a guarantee that you take your umbrella with you because the sun might be out in the morning, but during the afternoon, the rain clouds would come in. Why? Because they were in the rainy season. But then here comes the hotter time, the dry season in which the rain doesn't fall. And you that have been there, my beloved brother, you see that during these seasons, things begin to dry up. It affects the farmers. It affects those that are in the industry where they have to work. They depend and they rely upon the rain. The rain, it quenches the thirst of the land. And the farmland receives its nourishment through the water that comes down. God When he created the heavens and earth, my beloved brother, he created everything so perfectly. Who could ever imagine in your mind, amen, that God in his perfect thinking, he would have the water come from the sky, amen. And in the rain, that it would quench the thirst of the earth. And it would nourish the plants, and it was able to give life to the plants. And because the plants and the vegetation have life, they're able to feed us. And because we are able to be fed, we have life. Amen. What a great, who is greater than our God? Hallelujah. There's nobody that can think like our God. He's an awesome, powerful Savior. And to think, my beloved brother, that different times when you go through a drought and a dry season, no rain falls, and sometimes we see the land begins to dry up. The water brooks, the lakes, the rivers, they begin to low and go down, and to the point that the water dries up. And sometimes if you ever view, and you can see on the National Geographic, or you can look in the magazines, in Africa, when they go through their dry season, the elephants, they die, the lions, they're so thirsty. For just one drink of water, they'll travel for kilometers and kilometers trying to find just one little drop of water to quench the thirsting of their soul, amen, to give them life. Droughts, it affects for so long. And the Bible here is talking about in 1 Kings. We see that the prophet Elijah, there's a drought in the land. For 3.5 years, no rain has fallen. For 3.5 years, the water brooks are drying up. For 3.5 years, the plantations and the vegetations are dying. For 3.5 years, the animals, the wildlife is dying because they cannot get the quenching of their thirst. My beloved brethren, they say that you can only live for 3 to 4 days without water. For 3.5 years, the animals were dying, the vegetation was dying, everything was drying up. It was dry for so long that many people had no idea what rain was. Can you imagine, my beloved brethren, little children, that never knew what it was like to play in the rain? They didn't know what it was like to play in the puddles and jump and splash the water up. They never knew what it was like because they never experienced rain. Can you say praise the Lord? Sometimes, my beloved brother, we deal with droughts as a symbol of hard times. Droughts are symbols and significant because it is symbolizing and is compared to times in our lives of struggle. Times in our lives where a drought, a dry season, where things don't always go the way that we think they should. Can you say praise the Lord? Sometimes in your life, my beloved brother, you will have a drought or a dry season in your finances. Maybe sometimes in your life you'll have a dry season in your emotional, in your work status, where you cannot find work in the work, the industries that you're in, your professions in. Sometimes in your life you'll find yourself struggling just to get up every day and to move forward. Can you say praise the Lord? The devil will always try to do everything he can to keep you in a drought. The Bible says the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy. The devil is not your friend. The devil is the enemy. He is the adversary. But why is it so many times, my beloved brethren, when we are going through a trial of the faith, when we're going through difficult times, we would rather turn to the devil than turn to our loving God? Can you say praise the Lord? You look through the world, and the world goes through different trials and tragedies. And instead of turning and surrendering to God, it's almost as they curse God and they spit in his face and they turn more to the world. Why would we turn from the Savior? He is the Redeemer of the world. He is the rock that we run to. Come on, somebody. He is a strong tower the righteous run into and are safe. Can you say praise the Lord? A spiritual place, my brothers and sisters. He is that rock that we turn to. He is that rock that we lean on. But sometimes, my beloved brother, the Bible says the rain falls on the just and the unjust. Sometime in your life, you're going to go through trials, and you're going to go through temptations, and you're going to go through persecution. You're going to go through the droughts of your life. But stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. That God has not forgotten you. God will never leave you nor forsake you. He will be with you to the end of the world. Can you say praise the Lord? Can you imagine how the brethren felt during the times of Elijah? For 3.5 years, they prayed. And it seemed as if God was not hearing them. Amen. Finally, one day, my beloved brethren, Elijah was on top of Mount Carmel. And he said, I want you to prepare for rain. What? Bucket? It's not rain for 3.5 years. Amen. Uh-huh. Why would we prepare for rain now?
Amen.
Elijah said, go prepare. Because the rain is coming. The refreshing rain is going to fall again. The healing for our land is going to happen again. The refreshing of our plants and our lives and the animal lives. Everything that we have lost will be restored when the rain falls. Prepare for rain. And the Bible says that even before it rained, Elijah began to pray. He put his head in between his legs and he began to pray. And he told one of the servants, one of the young men, he said, go, look and see if you see rain. Look out in the sky. Tell me if you see any clouds. The Bible said that this young man, he walked to the mountain and he looked over the sky. Voila. No clouds in the sky, nothing there. He comes back to Elijah with the grim report. Elijah, we see nothing. There's nothing there. Go look again, Elijah said. The young man walked to the mountain again and he looked over the sky. Again, there's nothing there. The sun is shining down. The sun is burning the ground there. It is dry. Nothing's there. He comes back to Elijah. Beloved Elijah, there's nothing there. Nothing in the sky. Nothing around. Elijah did not get discouraged.
Amen.
But he said, go look again.
Yes.
This young man went a third time. Found nothing. Went 4 times, he found nothing. He went back 5 times and gave the report. Elijah, there's nothing there. 6 times, Elijah said, go back and look again.
Right.
And on the 7th time, my beloved brother, the Bible says that there, the young man looked out upon the sky. Hallelujah. And there he finds just a little cloud. Just a little cloud. All the times before, he's seen nothing. Can you say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
All he ever seen was nothing. But on the 7th time, he sees just a small hand. A cloud the size of a man's hand. And he comes back and he says, Elijah, there's a cloud coming. My beloved brother, the Bible said that the rains fell. Torrential rain. An outpour came from heaven that washed over the land. And the drought ended that day. Can you say praise the Lord? Can you say praise the Lord? What are you talking about, beloved Minister Luke? I've come to tell you this here. In the United Kingdom, many of you have served God. And you've been this miracle crusade for years. Right now, my beloved brethren, here in the United Kingdom, the membership and those that attend churches has become less than 8%. Not many people attend church here in the United Kingdom. I was talking to the Bishop Sanguinetti, and I was telling him, I said, we're just beginning. We only have maybe 20 brethren here. And he said, oh, that's good. He said, if you have that many, that's a great crowd. He said, here in England, crowds are not that big. Many times you just have to have service in your homes. So like right now, he looked out and he said, today, when I walked into the back, he said, this is great. God is moving in the Jesus miracle crusade. And sometimes, my beloved brethren, it's tempting to look in the Amaranto Sports Complex and see thousands. And it's tempting to look and say, oh, what are we doing? We're just a smaller crowd. There's nothing here. But my beloved brethren, I've come to build your faith that God has placed you here for a purpose. And at times such as this, my beloved brethren, we are coming to the point of the last days where Jesus Christ is coming back again. Jesus, my beloved brethren, is coming back again. One day, very soon, the Bible says that he's coming back like a thief in the night. The Bible warns us to watch and be ready, for the bridegroom comes. Jesus is coming. We must be prepared. We must be watching. We must be waiting. Can you shout hallelujah? Sometimes it's easy. When you're witnessing to your beloved co-workers, you're talking to your neighbors, and you ask them to attend, and they say no. It's easy for us to sometimes get discouraged and feel like we're in a drought, that there's no answer, that nobody's hearing us. Sometimes we feel like we're in a drought spiritually. Oh, if we could just be back at the Jesus Miracle Crusade in Amaranto. But don't you know, my beloved brethren, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Jesus is omnipresent. That means today, with our beloved brethren, we're worshiping the Lord and jumping in the Amaranto Sports Complex. And when they were in Baguio City, jumping and worshiping the Lord in Baguio City. And you go down to Cebu, and they were worshiping the Lord. And Cebu and the brethren were worshiping the Lord. And Davao, the brethren were worshiping the Lord. Here in San Francisco, and Atlanta, Georgia, and Toronto, Canada. The same God that they're praising, that's with them as today, here in London with you. Clap your hands and thank the Lord. He's the same God in the Philippines as he is here today. Jesus Christ has never left us. He'll never forsake us. Shout hallelujah. My beloved brother Elijah was a prophet. And he still went through the drought. We are going to go through hard times. We're going to go through difficult times. And sometimes you may look and say, Lord, when is the rain going to come to my life? When are you going to quench the thirsting of my soul? And you might look out and see nothing. You might pray, my beloved brethren, and feel nothing. You might seek him and sometimes search and feel like there's nothing there. But I pray and I ask you in Jesus' name, keep looking. If you haven't felt anything today, go back one more time. Just keep going back. And I promise you, my beloved brother, Jesus Christ will never fail us. He's never failed us before. And he'll never fail us ever again. Jesus Christ cannot lie to us. And what he has promised, he will keep his word. Can you say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
We have to keep holding on to God's unchanging hand. You have to keep holding on because there are blessings on the other side of nothing. There's blessings on the other side of the clouds. There's miracles, signs, and wonders that are going to come to London. And my beloved brethren, you just watch and see. You just wait and see what God is going to do in the London outreach. You just wait and see. Can you sing praise the Lord? I remember being in San Francisco.
Amen.
Beloved sister Faith is with us, Faith Oscar. I remember being there in San Francisco with my beloved wife Deb when they first opened the outreach. We were having service, brethren. We were having service in the living room, just as big as a stage. And the only thing that we had for a pulpit was a couch. So I would preach with my Bible on the back of the couch. And there were only maybe 6, 7, 10 brethren. And then it grew. We'd go back the next year, and there was 15. The next year, maybe 20, 25. And by the time now, brethren, they have their own church building where all the Jesus Miracle Crusade can come into worship. Over 200 brethren that are there. But for years, there was only just a few. Some people say, why bother? Why go? There's nothing. Why start an outreach in San Francisco? There's nobody there. There's nothing there. What if happened if our beloved pastor would have said, go back to San Francisco, go back to Manila. There's nobody there. All those people would be left alone. But through the prayers of our beloved pastor, the preaching and this fasting, hallelujah, now we have an outreach there in San Francisco, in Los Angeles, and San Jose, and Atlanta, in New Jersey, hallelujah, all over the United States, in North Carolina. About 5 or 6 years ago, we were in Toronto, Canada, 7, I believe, 7 years ago. We were there the very first anniversary. And we did not even have anywhere to worship. So we had to rent a pub. Amen. We were renting a pub. And there were beer signs behind us, lit up. And we were sticking the Jesus Miracle Crusade banners over top of the cover of the beer signs. Because we wanted to make that bar, that beer, that pub a holy place where we could worship the Lord. And there was only about 10 of us. Amen. And that day we baptized 2 people in the name of Jesus. And we had to go baptize them in a bathtub. And the bathtub was so small that when we pushed them down, all the water came out. And you had to hold them there so the water would come back over and baptize them. We were there this year, my beloved brother, over 75 members of the Jesus Christ Crusade. Hallelujah. They have their own place of worship. And I see and I feel the same thing today as I felt then. God is with you. God is here. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. Jesus has never failed us. We are part of the body of Christ. Jesus said, upon this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Can you say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
I'm reminded, my beloved brother, in the Bible, a man by the name of Jairus. Jairus had a daughter that was sick. She was sick to the point that she was dying. And Jairus had a decision to make. Do I stay home with my dying child and be with her in the last moments of her life? Or do I go to the city where there's a man named Jesus? They say that he heals. They say he delivers. They say that he saves. Do I stay here or do I go and seek help? My beloved brethren, he made the decision to go to where Jesus was. His heart was breaking because he wanted to be with his daughter. But he wanted to go where there was hope.
Amen.
There, my brother, there Jairus finds our dearest Jesus. And Jesus is walking. And there's a multitude of people around him. Jairus, he fights through the crowd. And finally he gets to the face of Jesus, and he says, dearest Jesus, will you come with me to my house? My daughter is dying. And when Jesus began to follow, oh, Jairus' heart was overwhelmed. His heart was leaping. Finally, Jesus is coming with me. Amen. But as he walked, you remember the story of the woman that had the issue of blood for 12 years. While Jesus and Jairus begin to walk, the woman with the issue of blood crawled to the feet of Jesus. And she pulled on the hem of his garment. And Jesus stopped to heal her. And Jairus was there. He was walking. And he was so excited. And when he looked back, Jesus wasn't there. He was a distance away.
Right.
Oh, his heart was broken. Jairus, you had Jesus with you.
Uh-huh. Right.
But you turned your back to walk. And he was distracted.
Right.
And now he's away from you again. And the Bible said that while Jairus was going back to Jesus, someone came to him and said, Jairus, your daughter has died.
Amen.
They were saying, why bother with Jesus?
Right.
She's dead. Why bother? Mm-hmm. Why bother praying anymore? Why bother seeking after Jesus?
Right.
It's over. But my beloved brother, Jesus and Jairus got together. And Jesus healed Jairus' daughter and raised her from the dead. What if Jairus would have listened to all the people around him? What if Jairus would have listened to the doubters and the skeptics that say, you're wasting time praying. You're wasting time fasting. You're wasting time. What would happen, my beloved brother, if our beloved pastor would have listened to other people that said, you're wasting your time. You're not a prophet of God. What would have happened? No. He heard the voice of our dearest Jesus. And he followed. And because of that, my beloved brother, the Philippines has been turned around. Amen. Millions of people have heard the gospel of Jesus Christ. Can you say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
Can you stand to your feet, my beloved brother? Thank you so much. So I want to tell you today. I've come to, on this third anniversary, I've come to encourage you. I've come to encourage each and every one of you that God is with you.
Amen.
That sometimes when you're working and sometimes when you're praying and sometimes when you're asking people, inviting them to come to church, come to the Jesus Miracle Crusade, sometimes you feel that they're not answering. And you keep praying for the Lord to hear your prayers and to heal your family, to save your family. And sometimes you feel like there's nothing coming back. I want to encourage you to keep praying.
Hallelujah.
Keep seeking the Lord.
Amen.
Keep going to the mountaintop until you see Jesus.
Amen.
He's coming back. Amen.
Amen.
Keep going and keep praying.
Hallelujah.
Be steadfast in prayer. Be steadfast in your fasting. And watch God work a miracle. This is the best decision you can make. To live your life for Jesus. Nothing is better. Nothing is better than living and asking the Lord to come into your heart. I think that everyone that is here today, if I asked all the beloved brethren here, do they regret giving their hearts to Jesus? They would tell you no. It's the greatest thing they ever did was to ask our dearest Jesus to come into their life. So today, if you've come here as a guest, you've come here as a visitor, we do not want to embarrass you. We do not want to make you feel out of place, but we want you to receive the Lord into your heart. Amen. If you receive the Lord, if you accept the Lord today, the Lord will accept you when you go to heaven.
Yes.
If you deny him, the Lord says, I'll deny you before my Father. Amen.
Amen.
So today is a day of salvation. Today is a day where you say, Lord, come into my heart. Make me a new creature. Amen. All things pass away. All things become new. God bless you, sweetheart.